Thank you.
Thanks, Hilton, for that very nice introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here, this beautiful setting, to tell you my story. So my story, let me find my pointer. Yep, it works. So my story begins, it's a story really about how we got here, or rather how our galaxy, our home, the Milky Way galaxy, got here. So we live in a galaxy that looks rather like this one. We live about two-thirds of the way out in one of the spiral arms. This is actually not our galaxy, because it would be very hard to take a picture of our galaxy from a distance. This is actually our sister galaxy. It's our sister spiral galaxy, Andromeda. And it's in our backyard. It's about 2.5 million light years away. And for those of you that don't have these numbers at your fingertips, a light year is the distance light traveling at 186,000 miles a second travels in a year. So it's a very long way. But that's our backyard, and I'll push our story much further away. Astronomers like to use the term parsec when they talk about distance. So you'll hear the word parsec in the talk. And one parsec is about 3.25 light years. So let's start the story at the very beginning, but actually we can't quite do that. At the beginning, there was the Big Bang that started everything. Our math and science isn't able to take us back to time t equals zero. It can only go back to about 10 to the minus 43 of a second. And we know that at that time, the universe was very hot and very dense. So it was actually about 10 to the power 32 degrees Kelvin. That's a 1 and 32 zeros. As time evolves in the universe expands and cools. So there's an important milestone in the evolution of the universe, which happens at 380,000 years after the Big Bang. And that's an important point because at that time, the temperature of the universe has reached a mere 3,000 degrees and a veil is lifted. So at the very beginning, we have a soup of matter and radiation, and matter is spontaneously turning into energy in the form of photons, bundles of light energy. And those bundles of light energy are spontaneously turning into particles, to matter, and back and forth and back and forth. As the universe cools a bit further from the very beginning, in a fraction of a second, we have electrons whizzing around in the universe and photons that are also there off and on, they bang into these electrons. And the universe is consequently opaque because photons trying to get out can't. They just keep banging into these electrons that are whizzing around at these high temperatures. So if we're over here now, present day, looking back in time to the Big Bang, we can look at the afterglow of the Big Bang because we can see back to the moment when the veil was lifted, when the universe had cooled enough for electrons to glom onto protons and make atoms. And at that moment, or at that time, the universe became transparent, became visually transparent. The photons could fly through the universe to the present day where we can record them on our telescopes. So when we look back in time, we can look at the afterglow of the Big Bang. There's a period after that where nothing much happened. We call those the Dark Ages. Matter was organizing itself. And later we get the development of galaxies and eventually planets and us at the present day. So this is the baby picture. The baby pictures of the universe look like this. This is actually a temperature map of the very early universe. It's the afterglow from the Big Bang. And it's called the cosmic microwave background. Since the time when the veil was lifted and photons flooded freely through the universe has cooled so that this afterglow is now in the microwave part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So this map is very uniform, even though it doesn't look that way. The difference between the coldest spot in this temperature map and the hottest spot, so the coldest spots are in dark blue and the hottest spots are in red, the difference between the hottest and coldest parts is only 400 millionths of a degree. So this map looks a bit ripply, but actually it's very, very uniform. So let's whiz forward to the present day, and we see a field, which is the extreme deep field. It's a field that the Hubble Space Telescope stared at for actually about 23 days in total, and it was selected to be nothing much in particular, just a place in the sky where nothing particular was going on. Staring at this, oh, and by the way, this field is the size of a grain of sand held at arm's length. When you look at the image that Hubble has produced, this entire image is filled with galaxies. Virtually every speck in this image is a galaxy. A galaxy with, as Hilton told you, typically maybe 10 to the power 12 stars. So that's a 1 and 12 zero stars, each one of these. Some of them are small because they're intrinsically small. Some of them are small because they're big, but they're very far away. There's only one or two foreground stars in this field, and they're quite apparent. All the rest are galaxies. So extrapolating from this tiny piece of the sky, we can calculate that there are about 200 billion galaxies in the universe. And of course, each of those galaxies contains billions of stars. So it's been calculated that there are more stars than all the grains of sand on all the beaches on Earth. So that number comes out to be about 10 to the power 22. Now, in addition to the stuff that you can see in an image like this, there's a lot of things we can't see. There are black holes, there is dark matter, and there is dark energy. In fact, we've got the tail wagging the dog, very much so. There's a total amount of energy in the universe that was determined at the Big Bang and basically doesn't change, but energy can turn into matter and matter can turn into energy. And in the early universe, it was going back and forward between matter and energy all the time. Today, we have an energy mass budget that looks like this. The stuff we can see is about, in terms of stars, which are the easiest to see, it's only about 0.5% of the total. So we're really having to do a good Sherlock Holmes thing to try and figure out what's going on based on just a tiny fraction of the mass energy budget of the universe. The total in terms of baryons are ordinary matter. It's what you and I are made of. It's what planets and stars are made of. That's only 4%. Dark matter accounts for 22%, and all the rest is dark energy, about 74% of this total. So the question that I'm going to try and address tonight is, how do we get from A to B? How do we get from that hot, homogeneous soup of matter and radiation that was very, very uniform to the present day where the universe is filled with structure? Well, the first thing we do is we put our math and physics from time almost t equals zero, time 10 to the minus 43 of a second. We put that math and physics into the biggest supercomputers we can find, and we press go. And we run our simulations, they're n-body dark matter simulations. We know we need to be thinking about dark matter. Without dark matter, we can't form galaxies at all. So we run our dark matter simulations forward from that very earliest moment to the present day, and we compare those simulations to what we observe. Of course, what we observe with Keck. So the first thing I'm going to show you is one of those simulations. And you'll see as the simulation goes on that we start with that homogeneous, almost fog-like distribution of dark matter. And as time goes on, we'll see structure emerging. It's actually the Millennium simulation, I think. Yes, here we go. And so, very large number of particles. This is a billion parsecs. Remember, a parsec is 3.25 light years. And you can see this web almost looks like a neural network. And we're going to home in on a place where many filaments come together. We're zooming in. And we're going to stop right around here. And the next slide will show you how the dark matter simulations relate to what we see. So on the left-hand side here is our dark matter simulation. This is just dark matter particles with all the best assumptions we can make about the physics in the simulation. And if you have to paste on baryons onto the dark matter, because the baryons are the things that we see. That's the ordinary matter. And so galaxy clusters are formed where these very dense dark matter aggregations occur, where the filaments come together. So this is a cluster of galaxies that we would see with our eyes and with our telescopes. And smaller clumps, like this little clump over here or this little clump over here, those are the things that become Milky Way sized galaxies. So a Milky Way sized dark matter halo like this can be the host of many different kinds of Milky Way sized galaxies. It's just a few, bit of an excuse just to show you pretty galaxy photos. So we know from these simulations that galaxies grow by hierarchical merging. So in other words, small lumps of baryonic matter come close to each other and glom together under the force of gravity. That makes a bigger clump, which has a stronger force of gravity pulling in its neighbors. And so structure builds up hierarchically. We know that much. But we don't know exactly how that happens, and we don't know exactly when it happens. And we certainly are not very happy about our theories of why different kinds of galaxies come to be. Why some galaxies are spirals like our own, why some are fuzzy football shaped galaxies, we call those the elliptical galaxies, and why some galaxies have this very, as Hilton said, poetic name, irregular galaxies, because they can't really figure out what kind of shape they want to have. So enter me and my group. I study, as Hilton said, globular star clusters. I actually study these globular clusters in combination with the galaxy starlight to try and understand how and when in the history of the universe galaxies formed. So we use these things as astronomical fossils. So my group is the SAGES group, Study of the Astrophysics of Globular Clusters in Extragalactic Systems. we like our acronyms. I'll show you a few more as we go along. This is some of my professional family. I think just about everybody in the SAGES group was either my postdoc or graduate student, or is a postdoc or graduate student of one of those people. So this is really my family. This is just a few of us. We were actually interviewing this bunny who was applying to be a SAGE, but we didn't accept him. We're very selective. So first of all, what are globular clusters? And why did they appeal to me over my entire career? Well, globular clusters are among the oldest radiant objects. They're certainly the oldest radiant objects that are accessible to detailed study. Here's a picture of one. It's a Hubble picture. It's globular clusters are about typically 100 million stars in a glob, hence the name. So why do we care about that? Well, virtually all galaxies have a retinue of globular clusters. They swarm around their host galaxies. This is an artist's sort of rendition of a globular cluster swarming around its particular host. And all galaxies have them. Dwarfs have a few, spirals have a few hundred, ellipticals can have up to tens of thousands of globular clusters in a swarm-like halo around their parent galaxy. So the important part, though, is that globular cluster formation accompanies all the major star-forming episodes in a galaxy's history. So they're bright because they're 100 million stars, so they're much brighter than the underlying starlight that makes up a galaxy. But once they're formed, they don't change. This is their great appeal, in my opinion. If you study galaxies directly, they're always changing. They're gobbling each other, they're having gas infalling, creating bursts of star formation that really muddy the waters about their assembly history. But once you form a globular cluster, it basically doesn't change throughout the history of the universe. So globular clusters are around for all the mergers and acquisitions that form the galaxies we see today. So they can help us understand when and how galaxies formed and the differences between them. How did they come about? Now, it sounds good, but it's a challenging area of research. I deal with galaxies beyond our local group of galaxies. And at those distances, a globular cluster like this is just a speck. It just looks like a point of light. It looks like an individual star, actually. So even though there are 100 million stars in there, they're still faint at the distances of the galaxies I study. They're superimposed on the background light of their parent galaxy. And because they're just a speck, they're difficult to distinguish from foreground stars and background galaxies. So we have to have the big guns. We need Keck, and here's, you all know and love Keck, and we need support from very high quality images that we get from the Hubble Space Telescope and also from our friends at Subaru. So here's a simulation of what we call a major merger. So on the left is gas, on the right is stars. And what it's showing is two Milky Way-like galaxies, two disk spiral-type galaxies banging together. And this is what we call a major merger. A major merger is when two roughly equal mass galaxies collide and merge. And you can see there's a face-on view at the top, edge-on view at the bottom. The gas on the left isn't doing exactly the same as the stars on the right. But at the end of this simulation, you see that you wind up with something that looks very much like an elliptical galaxy. It's got a little bit of dross around the outside that'll get swept up later on. So there, partly because of mergers such as this, and partly because of observations of major mergers, we do see major mergers happening in our local universe, this paradigm for forming elliptical galaxies by banging together spiral galaxies, this paradigm held sway for decades, and it was thought to be essentially the main way that you could form elliptical galaxies in our universe. We know that, in fact, not only do we occasionally see major mergers happening, but we know that the Milky Way is going to collide with and merge with Andromeda in about 3 billion years. No stars will collide because stars are very distant, even in the centers of galaxies, they're very distant from each other. But these two spirals will collide. And this is not a real photograph, but just a kind of fun way of showing you what will happen. Here's Andromeda in the sky. Here's the Milky Way. Uh-oh, here comes Andromeda. Here it comes. Here it comes. It's closer. Well, actually, let's go back one, two. When the galaxies actually collide, there's going to be a very spectacular night sky. Not that there'll be anybody around to see it, because we will have had to have evacuated about 2 billion years earlier. But there'll be a lot of star formation, and in fact, new globular clusters will be forming from the gas that collides in this merger. And then eventually the sky will settle down, the two nuclei, the two bulges of the galaxies will merge, and you'll wind up with an elliptical galaxy. So we know that that will happen, and we know that it happens from time to time in our local universe. The question is that the main route to forming elliptical galaxies? Well, there's an alternative view, and that's called the two-phase galaxy formation paradigm. And it's a very simple concept. The simple concept is you form a nugget, at least 10 billion years ago, and you grow it over cosmic time by raining in of little galaxies or little clumps of dark matter and build up the galaxy over time. So this is just a simulation of a nugget that's gobbling a little tiny galaxy nearby. So these nuggets are supposedly spinning. So here's to show you, just to go back one. If you want to find out if this paradigm is correct, it's fairly intuitively obvious that you want to observe a galaxy out to large radius. You want to get way out into the outskirts of the galaxy and find out how it grows. But traditionally, the surveys that have looked at galaxies have looked only in the very centers, particularly the ones that map the galaxies in two dimensions, make a two-dimensional map of the chemistry or the motions of the stars in the galaxy. Just concentrate on the center. But in fact, if you do that, you miss most of the action. So the traditional observations sit down here. This is fraction of the total on this side against the number of half-light radii. So a half-light radius is shown with this dashed line, and by definition, the half-light radius is the radius that contains half the light or half the stellar mass. So this curve shows you how stellar mass increases as you go out from the center. But if you only look in this inner region, you miss 90% of the total mass. So the total mass is the mass that includes dark matter. And the dark matter is distributed much more widely in a galaxy than the stellar mass. So the stellar mass is in the center, and there's this halo of dark matter around galaxies. So these considerations motivated me and my group to start what we call the Slug Survey. So the Slug Survey is the SAGE's Legacy Unifying Globular Clusters and Galaxies Survey. And we came up with that. Yes, it was a lot of time and efforts on the acronym. We do also do serious science, but we do love our acronyms. We came up with that because the banana slug is the emblem of UC Santa Cruz, where we're headquartered. So after much effort, we got the name down, and then we proceeded to put in the proposals to get our KEK time and follow up with the survey. So the survey uses KEK, DMOS in particular, for our spectroscopy, and we do our imaging with the Subaru Suprime Cam and with the Hubble Space Telescope. So we're supported by these telescopes, and then we use KEK DMOS to do our spectroscopic follow-up. So we make two-dimensional maps of the chemical element abundances in galaxies and the how the stars and the star clusters are moving, the kinematics, out to very large radii. So we get the galaxy starlet out to 3 half-light radii. Remember, the traditional surveys were less than 1 half radius, a half-light radius. And we're able to use the globular clusters because they swarm around the galaxy. We were able to use those to study galaxies out to 10 half-light radii. And I just want to illustrate how important this is. So if you're only looking in the middle, let's say 6/10 of a half-light radius, you just get this inner region here. This is 1 half-light radius on a side. This is a velocity map. So this shows you a galaxy that's spinning. The blue part is approaching, and the red part is receding. So this is a spinning system. If you go out to 3 half-light radii, you see that there's a rotation actually orthogonal to this rotation, it's spinning. If you go still further out, this is 7 half-light radii, you can see a great deal of complexity that helps you really understand how this galaxy has grown over cosmic time. So going back to that cosmic web that I showed you at the very beginning, it turns out that if you follow how gas flows along these dark matter filaments in the cosmic web, you find that it flows into small radii along the cosmic web and makes little disks. So these little disks, they form at 10 billion years ago or longer, and there's simulations, cosmological simulations, which suggest that the gas streams in, makes these little disks. These little disks clump up, and maybe those clumps are where young globular clusters form, incidentally. But these clumps migrate through instabilities and form what looks very much like the bulges of galaxies we see today. So this wild disk idea, this model, was something we decided to test with the slug survey. So I'm going to show you two different sets of results from the slug survey. One is testing this wild disk model. So there's more velocity maps. This is data on a particular galaxy. Again, you can see it's rotating. Red is receding. Blue is coming towards us. It's spinning. And this is a cosmological wild disk model. So this is this two-phase simulation down here. Now, they're not at the same scale, but what you see in both of them is that as you go out from the center of the galaxy, the velocity rises at first, and then it drops off. If you're only looking in the center, where that ellipse is, that black ellipse is situated, you wouldn't see that fall off. But that fall off is extremely important in discriminating between these two competing scenarios for how you form galaxies. So here we have the cosmological wild disk simulation in turquoise. Here you have the blue things are the data. These are our slugs data. And here is what major mergers do. This banging together of two disk galaxies to form an elliptical galaxy. And they basically always have this rising velocity profile. So this is rotational speed against distance from the center of the galaxy. So this is a very, very strong indicator that the two-phase paradigm, the one where you have a nugget at high redshift and you grow it over cosmic time, is the main path for forming the galaxies that we see around us. And the major merger one, although we know it happens sometimes, does not seem to be the main route. So my other part, so this is kind of like the second part of my talk. This is a talk about ultra compact dwarfs. And this was actually, it started off as a sort of a bonus to the slug survey. It was a spin-off that turned out to be extremely revealing about galaxy formation and evolution. So this is about ultra-compact dwarfs around the galaxy M87. So M87 is the most massive elliptical galaxy in the Virgo cluster of galaxies. So it's about 60 million light years away. Again, really very, very close by astronomy standards. So every speck around here is basically a star cluster, except when we were studying this galaxy as part of the slug survey, we found something very interesting. So if you cast your eyes up here to this upper corner and we look within this square, let's blow it up and see what we see. Well, we certainly see things that are globular cluster-like, as expected. There's a globular cluster, there's a globular cluster. Here's a globular cluster that's how Omega Sen would look if it was at the distance of Virgo. Omega Sen is a globular cluster in the Milky Way. In fact, it's the most massive globular cluster in the Milky Way. So if you put that at the distance of M87, at about 60 million light years from us, that's what it would look like. Here's another famous Milky Way globular cluster. That's what it would look like. But then there's these other things. These are ultra-compact dwarfs. Now, ultra-compact dwarfs have been known about for a long time, about 15 years. And ever since they were discovered, people have been trying to figure out whether they're gigantostar clusters or whether they're just wimpy galaxies. And what we found in our survey was we found lots of these things, and we found them in to very faint magnitudes, so very faint brightnesses that people, they'd never been discovered before. So we found a very large number of them, and we also followed up our discovery of these things with spectroscopy so that we could get their, verify the distance that these things are really associated with this galaxy in Virgo, and get their characteristics using Keck spectroscopy. So one of the neatest results, I think, from this aspect, this little aspect of the slug survey, was the discovery of the densest galaxy. So this is the densest galaxy in the universe, at least up until now. So it's in a galaxy called M60. It's also in Virgo. It's an elliptical galaxy, has a neighbor that's a spiral galaxy. And if you wanted to see what a UCD, a not quote unquote normal UCD looks like, you probably can't, because it's this little speck over here. And it has about 3 million solar masses worth of mass in it. So it's bigger than a globular cluster, but it's a normal category UCD. Our densest galaxy is this fellow over here, which you can see much more clearly. So when we discovered this object, we also discovered that it has an X-ray source. It's an X-ray source. So we thought, aha, maybe it has a black hole in it, because X-rays and black holes tend to go together. So how do we figure out whether this galaxy, this ultra compact dwarf, has a black hole in its center? Well, the first thing I'd like to ask is, if the sun were turned into a black hole, what would happen to the Earth's orbit? Anybody guess? Well, I can show you, because I'm going to do magic. I'm going to shrink the sun to a black hole. If we shrunk the sun to a black hole, it would be about 3 kilometers in radius. So if you were to drive from here to the Apuna Prince, that would be further than the radius. So you'd have to smush all of the sun's mass into that very small volume. If you made the Earth into a black hole, it would be about 9 millimeters across. So let's squish the sun down and make it into a black hole, and let's see what would happen to the Earth's orbit. Here it goes. Yes, absolutely nothing would happen to the Earth's orbit, because black holes don't suck. So we don't have to worry about black holes going around the universe like vacuum cleaners and gobbling everything up. But there is a serious point that I'm going to make here, which is, if you increase the mass of the black hole, then there will be an effect on the orbit. As you can see, I'm going to increase the mass of the black hole by a factor of 100. So what happens is that the Earth's orbit speeds up. So if the Earth stays at the same radius, but the mass goes up, the Earth speeds up. So this would, of course, be true of a sun or a star going around a black hole. The more mass there is in the black hole, the faster the stars must be going around it. And the closer in they are, the faster they go. So this gives us a clue as to how we can establish the mass of a black hole. Obviously, we can't see the thing. This is an artist's rendition of a black hole. So we can use this effect on the orbits of the stars to measure the mass of the black hole. So we do that via this effect. It's the Doppler effect. We're all very familiar with it in our everyday lives. And what we're hearing in sound waves is the change of pitch as the siren approaches us, comes alongside us, and then recedes. So that change in pitch is really a change in frequency or wavelength. And it happens for light waves. Analogously to sound waves, light waves behave in a similar way. So if you've got a source of light, it's emitting light with a particular wavelength or set of wavelengths. And the wavelength is just the distance between two peaks or two troughs of this waveform. Now, if you move the source of light away from you, that stretches out the waves and makes the distance between the peaks, or the distance between the troughs, wider. That increases the wavelength. Similarly, or conversely, if you bring the source of light towards you, you squish up the waves and you make the wavelength shorter and the frequency higher. So using this Doppler effect, we can directly measure the speed with which stars are moving around our target black hole. Now, you're familiar with this already in the Milky Way, perhaps, because you may have heard Andrea Goetz talking about measuring the speeds of individual stars around the black hole in the center of the Milky Way. And of course, I'll just play that again so you can... Maybe I will. Oh, it'd be best if I didn't hit the shift button. Okay, here we go. So as you can see, the stars that are closest to the black hole shown by that star are moving faster than these ones that are farther away. Now, with our object, our densest galaxy, this fellow down here, we can't measure individual stars. This M60 UCD1, as we've so poetically called it, it's too far away for us to measure individual stars. We can only measure the cumulative effect of all the stars that are contained in this object, about 10 to the 8 of them. So in order to study this object, we actually had to use adaptive optics. So this image here is an image taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. We require that because we have to see the very fine detail that we need the resolution that Hubble can provide for that image. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to see how fast the stars move as you step out in radius from the center of this object. Now, this bar here that you can't see very well, it's basically the length of these numbers here. This is one arc second, is about this distance. So one arc second is the size of a dime at 2.5 miles. It is really tiny. And it is about typical image size at a ground-based telescope. Keck usually does a bit better than that, although Hilton, not usually on my nights for some reason. But I'm told the average is about 7/10 of an arc second. So this image is completely within the seeing disk, the image size of a ground-based telescope. So we can't do this experiment unless we use adaptive optics, which allow us to beef up our resolution enormously. So we've observed this object both with Keck adaptive optics and with Gemini adaptive optics. And what we've done is we've compared our findings to a model in which we've included a black hole. So what we've got is the speed of the stars, which I described to you earlier, the speed of the stars as you step out in radius from the center of our little UCD object. And all of this, this entire x-axis, is smaller than the image size on a ground-based telescope. So what we're looking for is the difference between the model with no black hole, shown with this dashed line, and the model with a massive black hole in the center. And the crosses here are the data. So we weren't, to be honest, incredibly surprised to find a black hole in this object. What we were surprised to find was how massive it was. So this was actually a Nature article led by my collaborator, Neil Seth. This is our little guy down here, our sweet little UCD1. It has a black hole mass of 21 million suns. The Milky Way has a black hole of 4 million suns. So this little guy is 15% of the mass of this galaxy. The black hole is 15% of the mass of the galaxy. The supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way is much less, and it's a tiny fraction of the mass of the galaxy. So this made a big splash. So here's what we think is going on. Here's a simulation by Holger Baumgart, one of my collaborators on this project. And what you can see is a galaxy's come along, it's got entrapped by the gravitational pull of M60, this galaxy here, and it's getting stripped. It's getting all of its stars stripped off as it passes back and forth through the gravitational potential of M60. And you'll see in just a moment, it will wind up where it's supposed to be over here. having left behind all of its stars, or most of its stars, to build up that galaxy. So what we see here is the smoking gun of this gradual growing process that we believe is the dominant mechanism for forming galaxies. So as part of the sludge survey, we're finding a lot of these things. Here's just a couple of ones that you might find interesting. This is a Milky Way analog. It's got a catalog phone number, 4651, but it's very much like the Milky Way. And it's got an object that's very much like Omega Sen, this most massive Milky Way globular cluster. And it's clearly the nucleus of a galaxy that's being stripped by the gravitational pull of this guy. So the former galaxy belonging to this is building up this galaxy, little by little. There's another one down here. Again, this is a disturbed spiral, and it's gobbling up a neighboring smaller galaxy and building itself up that way. So we're finding quite a few of these, and we're following up with Keck. It's vital to have Keck. It's very, very difficult work to get the to derive the masses of these things, confirm their distances, and relate them to the stellar streams in which they're embedded. But we're finding a range of masses from the most massive end of the globular cluster range all the way out to very significantly more massive objects. So this has raised the question, is there a genuine distinction between star clusters on the one hand and galaxies on the other? And if there is, where is that boundary and what does it mean in terms of galaxy formation? So those are some of the questions that we're grappling with. I wanted to give you an overview perspective and let you fly through the cosmic microwave background which surrounds us as we speak, through the build-up of filamentary structure. These are all galaxies in these filaments. This isn't dark matter now. This is the real universe. It's galaxies are the morphology you see them here, and at the places that you see them. This is derived from the Hubble, from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. So we're now flying around our local universe. Andromeda. We're going to fly in through the Milky Way. Some of you will recognize some of the nebulae. Those of you like have particular favorites, you can look out for your favorite one. Horsehead. Then we'll sit back and have a look at the night sky and realize what's out there. So that was my sort of overview slide, but I want to give you a bit of perspective. So it's interesting to think about 90 years ago, we didn't know if there were other galaxies in the universe besides our own. 80 years ago, we didn't know that the universe was expanding. 50 years ago, we didn't believe in dark matter, or at least we weren't convinced. 20 years ago, we didn't know that the universe was accelerating, expansion was accelerating. That's dark energy. We had no clue about dark energy. We didn't know the geometry of the universe or its ultimate fate. And today we don't know what we don't know, but we do know we have Keck. And I think this is a really important point. We know that Keck will be right there at the forefront, as it always has been. It will continue to be helping us understand the things we know about, as well as the things that will be great surprises in the future, which is what makes astronomy so exciting. So I'll just leave you with, I can't resist leaving you with one more beautiful simulation, and I'd be very happy to take questions.